TSMC's coming N2 process node is one of its most ambitious. In their 4Q 2023 earnings call, TSMC mentioned plans for three new N2 fabs in Hsinchu, Kaohsiung, and Taichung. Assuming those all get built, that's a lot of new fabs. But it's more than just that. There's also something special about the transistors for this new N2 process. In 2011, the semiconductor industry transitioned from planar transistors to 3D ones, the now famous FinFET. Over 10 years later, TSMC is joining Samsung and Intel in doing it again. In this video, we're going to talk about the vertically stacked, gate-all-around, nanosheet/nanowire, metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor. This video is brought to you by the Asianometry Patreon. Early access members get to see new videos first and selected references for those videos. Early access really helps me a lot, and I appreciate every pledge. Thank you, and on with the show. So what is a transistor? Most simply speaking, it's a switch actively controlled. There's a source and a drain. These are made from doping regions of silicon with a dopant element implanted using an ion beam. That process is called ion implantation. In between the source and drain, we have the gate and the gate oxide. These sit on top of the channel and control it through a phenomenon known as capacitive coupling. When the gate receives a certain voltage, referred to as the threshold voltage, it turns on, or opens. This allows the flow of electrons or electron holes from the source to the drain along the channel. This control of a material's ability to conduct such particles is known as the field effect, and this is how the semiconductor gets its name. The semiconductor material conducts only part of the time, ergo, the semi. And the transistor using the field effect means that we can call it a field effect transistor. Some of the first gates were made from metal, though many gates today are made from polycrystalline silicon, which is not a metal. The metal gate and the gate oxide together give us metal oxide. So all together now, we have the metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor, or MOSFET. Names are surprisingly descriptive in semiconductor land. There are many types and designs of transistors out there with varying trade-offs. While the MOSFET design is the most common, others do exist. For example, the industry largely uses bipolar junction transistors. These are named for having three regions of alternatively doped silicon or germanium, three regions, two borders, or junctions. In an integrated circuit, or IC, we use transistors to design logic gates and other blocks, like for memories. For instance, the SRAM that serves as an IC's embedded memory is made up of a varying number of transistors. In a perfect world, the transistor switches instantly, and when that transistor gate is closed, then there is zero current flowing through it. And when the gate is open, then there is no resistance slowing down the flow. But our world is imperfect, and though I like to say that that is where much of its beauty comes from, when it comes to transistors, we do somewhat demand perfection. After decades of shrinking the size of the original planar MOSFET, we started suffering a series of what we call short channel effects. Short channel effects come in two forms. First, threshold voltage, or the voltage at which the gate opens and creates the current between the source and the drain. When the channel was longer, the threshold voltage was constant and independent of any external factors. But when the channel got shorter, we discovered that the threshold voltage was no longer constant and independent. Instead, it was decreasing, or rolling off as the channel shortened. This in turn exacerbates something called sub-threshold leakage. When the gate's voltage lowers below the threshold, it's supposed to cleanly shut down the current between the source and drain. It doesn't always, and the residual current, like a dripping faucet, is called the sub-threshold leakage. The lower the threshold voltage is, the higher the sub-threshold leakage gets in turn. The second major manifestation of short channel effects in a transistor is drain-induced barrier lowering, or dibble. This is where the source and the drain are now so close together that electrons from the source can diffuse into the drain, often by burrowing under the gate like a rabbit. Dibble results in a tiny parasitic current flow, so the transistor is using power even when it is on quote-unquote standby and doing nothing. Multiply these two short channel effects over billions of transistors, and you got a serious power consumption problem. Short channel effects originate from interference via the electric fields coming out from the source and the drain. The original planar gate sits on top of the channel, touching it on just one side. An electric field projects from that planar gate in one direction, down through the channel and into the silicon. This controls the channel's behavior. But the source and drain project electric fields of their own, and those are now encroaching horizontally into the channel, stealing away, quote-unquote, the gate's control. Kind of like loud talk coming from your neighbors in a bar messing with your attempts to say sweet romantic things to Siri. For years, the industry knew that this was coming, but for a long time, they were able to ameliorate short-channel effects by lowering the voltage, heavily doping the channel, or reducing the depths of the source and drain. Another big move was replacing the gate oxide from its prior silicon dioxide to one with a higher dielectric constant, or K. This strengthens the gate's capacitance, thus making the electric field projected by the gate more powerful so to dominate the channel. Famously, Intel used high-K dielectrics like hafnium oxide in 2007 for their high-K metal gate. This use helped pave the way for advanced atomic layer deposition techniques down the line. Unfortunately, those methods have run their course, and thus an entirely new structure is needed to wrestle back control of the channel from the source and the drain. In 1984, two Japanese researchers, Sekigawa and Hayashi, published a paper proposing what they called multi-gate transistors. The authors proposed a transistor with two connected gates. They called it a double-gate MOS transistor, or XMOS, since it looked like the Greek letter Xi from the side. This brings us to the FinFET, which intensifies the gate's control over the channel by wrapping it around the channel, the eponymous fin, on three sides. The first commercial FinFET devices were produced by Intel and hit the market in 2011 at the 22-nanometer process node. TSMC and Samsung followed a few years later in 2013 with their 16 and 14-nanometer nodes, respectively. For more information about the FinFET and its origin, I did a video about it a little while ago. Go check it out. The gate all-around, or GAFET, iterates on the concept of the FinFET by wrapping the gate entirely around the channel, ergo the name gate all-around, which first came about in a 1990 paper by Jean-Pierre Collinge, M. H. Gao, A. Romano, and others. Actually, the name describes less a specific transistor structure, but rather a whole class of them. The big similarity between them being that their gates completely surround the channel rather than on just three sides. Within the overall GAFET category, we have two big subcategories, nanowires and nanosheets. The names describe the shape of the channel. Nanowire channels are rounder than sheets, and for some reason they remind me of steel rods punching through concrete blocks. The nanowire and nanosheet physical structures offer their own trade-offs. For instance, the nanowire's smaller channels give their gates more control over electron flow, but it also impedes the flow of electrons when the gate is open. This means that we likely have to stack these nanowires, but only so far, because if we stack too many too high, they might interfere with the interconnect layers built above them. The process flow for creating a FinFET is largely the same as those for making planar transistors. That's important. The semiconductor industry on the whole is highly evolutionary, not revolutionary. The most significant new step was making these dense, highly regular bunches of fins. They are patterned onto the silicon substrate using a certain type of double patterning lithography. After that, we create the wells that would eventually help make the source and the drain. We add a temporary dummy gate to help us build the rest of the gate stack, electrically isolate the transistor, demolish the dummy gate and build the real gate, and all of this is basically the same as with the planar transistor. With this, the front end of the process is done and we can now start adding interconnects for the back end. I mention all of this because the GAFET's process flow evolves again from the FinFET's. Using a deposition technique called epitaxy, we add several layers of silicon and silicon germanium on top of the silicon substrate. This is sometimes referred to as a super lattice. After that, we cut down through those layers of silicon and silicon germanium in order to produce a quote-unquote fin, much like the FinFET's fin. Special attention has to be paid to keeping the multi-layer stack free of deformations, as well as giving it a high aspect ratio, as in height to width, very tall and skinny. These are already important considerations for fin-fed fins. To prevent electrical crosstalk and also to help make the fins nice, we do shallow trench isolation. We pattern trenches around the transistor using lithography, dig them using reactive ion etch, and then fill them with oxide. Anyway, when that is done, we can etch away the silicon germanium, leaving the silicon layer suspended between the source and the drain. This draws from the world of MEMS, where we use, quote, sacrificial layers, end quote, to suspend tiny structures. To build the gate and the gate oxide, we use atomic layer deposition to surround the exposed channel wires. I covered ALD in a prior video. It is a precise method of applying layers of metals or chemicals, one atom-thick layer at a time. The big challenge is correctly aligning the gate material around the channel. Once this is done, we can build the rest of the gate around the channels like as with FinFETs and planar transistors. There, you have a GAFET. Just like when the industry switched from planar transistors to FinFETs, the gate all around transition offers benefits. One very significant benefit is the power draw. A 2020 study found that when it is turned off, a nanosheet gate all around transistor draws about 20 to 35% less power than a FinFET depending on the device's dimensions. In terms of speed and density, the gains are not as dramatic. For speed, it is about 10% at constant power, and for density, it is about 15% depending on your IC's mix of transistors, analog, digital, or SRAM. I feel like the power gains would be very interesting to chip designers of mobile and AI processing applications, the former because power is constrained, the latter because of the sheer amount of compute needed for modern AI devices. No wonder, then, that TSMC management said that they are seeing, quote, a much higher level of customer interest and engagement at N2 as compared with N3 at a similar stage, end quote. GAFETs will likely take existing AI accelerator chips a major step forward. TSMC has pretty much dominated the 10-plus years of the FinFET era, so much so that Samsung and Intel have basically waved the white flag on that, moving ahead to gate all around in an apparent attempt to grab share. Samsung really led that drive into GAFET. They've been doing research on it since at least 2003 with their multi-bridge channel metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor. They first began offering their GAFET process, named SF3E, sometime in mid-2022. While the node did indeed ship some products, those seem to have been mostly been crypto miner chips, no big digital logic products. Later in 2023, Samsung released their second generation GAFET node, SF3. We shall see the pickup amongst foundry customers. Intel's named their GAFET offering RibbonFET, or NanoRibbon, or whatever have you. The first process node of theirs to use it is 20A, an internal node scheduled for mid-2024. After that is 18A, the big process node that everyone expects will bring Intel back to the leadership position. Intel's GAFET processes, 20A and 18A, include a second interesting innovation, backside power. This is where we move the power lines to underneath the silicon substrate, opening additional space. TSMC's N2 will not have backside power until about a year later with their second generation N2 processes, N2P and N2X. Many people see this as a major advantage for Intel. Semiconductor industry watchers have long looked to the FinFET to GAFET transition as a potential turning point in the foundry competition. The first to ship with volume wins, or so the story goes. Only time will tell, but I do want to note close similarities between the process flows for the FinFET and GAFET. Being very good at the former will also help you be good at the latter. The planar transistor lasted 50 years as a leading-edge architecture. The FinFET lasted about 10 years on the leading edge. It's hard to say how long the GAFET will be, but what is next after that? The semiconductor industry's premier R&D institute is IMEC, located out in Belgium. In addition to the GAFET nanosheets or nanowires, they're looking at other transistor structures to take us even further beyond. One promising design is the fork sheet. Imagine a bundle of vertically stacked sheets and then put a wall down through the middle of those sheets. A fork sheet is only a few evolutionary steps away from the GoFET, which is good, and also offers higher gate control, which is very good. And then after that, IMEC has presented the complementary FET, or CFET, where we fold the nanosheets, or the fins, on top of one another. This one would make a true 3D transistor. Anyway, the industry has not even started thinking about bringing these things into production. But the work shows that people are forever looking ahead. Right now, though, we look towards to N2 and its brethren, coming in 2025. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.